coming. I think it's really safe to say that I'm probably the only person on this stage who actually requires an introduction. So I'm Bonnie Poon, Manager of Public Programs here at the Fowler Museum, and welcome. And thank you, of course, again, for coming and for being so patient. And so just if you would allow me, I have to say a few words of thanks to some of our funders before we get started. Jam Session, America's Jazz Ambassadors Embrace the World, is organized and circulated by Meridian International Center in Washington, D.C., and its Los Angeles presentation is supported in part by the UCLA Graduate Division, the UCLA School of the Arts and Architecture, Friends of Jazz at UCLA, Earl E. Gales Jr., Jenkins, Gales and Martinez, Inc., and the Shirley and Ralph Shapiro Director's Discretionary Fund. And co-sponsors include the Herb Alpert School of Music and the UCLA Department of Ethnomusicology. And our programming initiatives, including today's panel, were generously funded by the Ella Fitzgerald Foundation, the Ella Fitzgerald Charitable Foundation and the Avant Lenart Public Programs Fund. And of course, we'd like to thank our media sponsor, KJazz, 88.1 FM, and also special thanks to our jazz friends who made our stage set upstairs possible, Remo D. Belli, CEO and founder of Remo, Inc., Dennis Haggerty and Keyboard Concepts, String Season, Ben Rock Studios, Eric Gill, Joshua Darlington, Byron Reynolds, and of course our very own Emery Thomas. And without further delay, I'm going to turn it over to our moderator, Tom Schneider.
Thank you. Thanks for Shirley braving the weather to come out today. The 405 at Sunset Boulevard all of a sudden became so dark that I couldn't hardly even see anything, and then there were the puddles and everything else. So thank you for coming out. Sitting backstage with our eminent panel, I usually don't get intimidated that we're talking and everything else, and Quincy and Kenny are catching up, and they've known John for a long time. I'm suddenly getting a little bit intimidated back there by the giants that I'm with, but I'm going to try to just move ahead. Quincy Jones, I mean, doesn't really need an intro. I didn't know that he has won, is it 27 Grammys, am I correct? Did I hear that correctly? Okay. 27, probably the other one on the way. And of course, he's produced some of the biggest records of all time. Of course, Michael Jackson's Thriller. My admiration comes from other places as kind of a jazz fanatic and a purist. I just asked him, and he graciously signed a copy of the Donischagen Switzerland concert from 1960, where Quincy introduced Freddie Hubbard, who did an unbelievable solo on Stolen Moments. Beautiful, beautiful album that was captured, and if I'm not mistaken, I think the Complete European Concerts of 1960 is also available as an import.
What's that?
The Complete Concerts of 1960 in Europe is now available as an import.
Yes.
Hope you see a royalty payment from that. one never knows. But I also love Quincy for other reasons. There is a song that Quincy wrote called "The Midnight Sun Will Never Set," written by him and Henri Salvador, who was one of my favorite artists too. And Sarah Vaughan sings it, and you just say, "Oh my God!" I mean, it's just she could have just she could have become an operatic singer if she wanted to. It's just so beautiful, and it's the flute doubles and the saxophone solo and everything else. It's so lush. So, I mean, there's just no end to my esteem for him. There was a rumor floating around that maybe, President Obama would name Quincy as our musical minister of culture. That still hasn't happened, and one of the things that we're going to ask is, why don't we have a minister of culture here in America? There'd be no better person than Quincy Jones. Kenny Burrell, one of the giants of music, recording so many great records. His playing is admired by countless young guitar players, and you know how young guitar players are sitting in the front row and trying to figure out what he's playing. We're looking at, you know, playing with Coltrane, Gil Evans, Ike Quebec, Jimmy Smith, Paul Chambers, and Quincy. Yeah, thank you. I can't say how many records Kenny's been on. His own discography is a mile long, but he's toured Poland, Czechoslovakia, in other places during the Soviet occupation. Remember, the USSR, especially under Stalin, put jazz musicians in prison, and it went back and forth. It's very interesting, but Stalin condemned jazz completely, and then Hitler condemned jazz. So then Stalin had to say, oh, this is great music. We have to embrace it because we hate Hitler. So it went on and on, and finally when Stalin died in 53, all of a sudden there was this thaw, and there's so many people there, and we'll talk about that. These guys know 10 times more than I ever know. But I went to UCLA and USC, and there was no jazz department, and there was a guy named Paul Tanner that taught at UCLA. But now Kenny and Gerald Wilson and down at USC, there's Alan Pasqua and Peter Erskine and all these jazz departments. I wish that they were around when I went to school, because there was nothing quite like it. So thank goodness the teaching is just so incredibly important. Our other panelist is John Hassey. He's the Smithsonian Institution's jazz guy. He is the author of the Jazz, the Smithsonian Anthology, which I think is just about to come out, something like that. He wrote a biography, biography of Duke Ellington, major study of jazz music called Jazz, the First Century. He's kind of been all over the place as an ambassador of jazz all over the U.S. as well as all around the world. So we're very happy to have him on the panel. I'm Tom Schnabel. I'm a radio guy. I do some books and features for PRI's The World, things like that. But the thing that got me into music was hearing John Coltrane's India on an Impulse album called Impressions when I was about 15 years old, and it changed my life, and it made me realize how deep music goes into my own, you know, young kind of idiotic spirit, and it never ever went away. So I'm here, and I'm very happy to be here. So welcome to our panelists, welcome to you in the audience. I think John, will sort of start with you, because you're going to do a short presentation of some of the things that you do with the Smithsonian, and then we're going to turn it over to everybody and explore this fascinating subject. I forgot to mention that when I used to interview, I started interviewing in 1979, and if you had a Russian pianist in or a Polish pianist in, or, you know, singers, they always mention, you know, how jazz was like the forbidden fruit and how important and how it represented not only this musical genius, but freedom as well. So it's an incredibly wonderful subject and very, very under examined. So I'm glad that we're all here today. And John, we'll start with you.
Thank you, Tom. If you feel the slightest bit intimidated, I feel like the ringer on this panel. it's a great honor and pleasure. I've got about a 5-minute presentation about what the Smithsonian does in regard to jazz and cultural diplomacy. Most of what the Smithsonian does is at the National Museum of American History, where I've had the privilege of working for 27 years. We document jazz and cultural diplomacy, for example, through the vast Duke Ellington collection, which is 100,000 pages of music, another 100,000 pages of documents. Here's a program for when he performed in 1973, command performance for Emperor Haile Selassie of Ethiopia. And this is the medal that Emperor Selassie gave Ellington on that night. There's many photographs. Here he is in St. Petersburg, then Leningrad. Isn't that a wonderfully contrasting photo?
Yeah.
And here he is in India, listening to some Indian musicians. And here he is with Paul Gonzalez, the little repast.
Bubbly, bubbly pipe.
You're right. And here is Mulatu Astatke in Addis Ababa 2 years ago. He's the father of Ethio jazz. He worked with Ellington when Ellington was there in 1973, and I had the pleasure of doing an oral history with him for the Smithsonian's collections. This Dizzy Gillespie's trumpet, you can see the references to playing abroad. And here is Cuba's great pianist Chucho Valdez a few months ago, backstage, if you will, at the Smithsonian, holding Gillespie's trumpet and being thrilled. He was a friend of Dizzy's. Quincy's gotten a chance to do that too, come back and hold Dizzy's Gillespie's trumpet.
You have one of the original one. Gave me the original horn.
Yeah, that's great. That's great. This is the French-Vietnamese Nguyen Le, fine guitarist, again, backstage at the Smithsonian, checking out some of our jazz collections. We also exhibit jazz and cultural diplomacy. This is an exhibit that went around the world through the State Department. It's a poster show on Duke Ellington, still playing in various countries. Here it is in Cape Town, South Africa, a few years ago. And we also celebrate jazz through cultural diplomacy, through Jazz Appreciation Month, which was kicked off in 2001 when Quincy came to the Museum of American History and helped us make the announcement of this new initiative. It's now celebrated all 50 states and 40 countries around the world, and two of the sponsors of Jazz Appreciation Month are represented today, the Ella Fitzgerald Foundation and the Herb Alpert Foundation. Rich Rossman and Fran Morris Rossman, wave your hands. The posters, each year we put out a new poster, and these are extremely popular around the world. I've seen them in grade schools, colleges, conservatories, radio broadcasting stations. We work with the State Department to send these out. And Jazz Appreciation Month is celebrated far and wide, from Australia to Russia. Here's a celebration in Estonia. Even sparked a jazz poster contest. Jazzaku means Jazz Month in Estonian, and little kids got involved throughout the country creating posters for Jazz Month. We work with the State Department, the Voice of America. Next month, the Voice of America is doing 10 shows throughout April for Jazz Appreciation Month. And through the State Department, we sometimes do digital video conferences. This picture was shot at the U.S. Embassy in Mauritius. There's a couple of local musicians playing, and then a little picture is I'm in the studio in Washington talking about Duke Ellington. They have a poster show there. This is also in Mauritius with they borrowed the State Department's exhibition on Louis Armstrong, which we helped to put together. And we've lent some photos to the jam session, which you can see upstairs. The touring that we do has involved our jazz orchestra, which I'll get to in a moment. And I've had the honor of working in, 15 countries. There's a lecture on Ella Fitzgerald. This is students at Addis Ababa University in Ethiopia 2 years ago. Here's a literally dirt poor community school in Lusaka, Zambia, where most of the students are extremely poor. This is one-on-one with a young lady pianist in Nairobi, Kenya, and some students and young musicians who had just heard a talk on Louis Armstrong, and inspired by Louis Armstrong, they said, "Life will never be the same." This is the power of American jazz musicians, even no longer living ones.